It's the ultimate challenge. A group of strangers forced to work together while battling the elements and each other. They must learn to adapt or they'll be voted out. 39 days, 18 people, one survivor.
In case you didn't know, I am a full-on Survivor fan. Have been for about 4 years now. And I have since decided to review the first 35 seasons of Survivor. But I didn't particularly want to review all of the seasons in order because that's boring and pedestrian. So here's what I decided to do instead. Journalist and Entertainment Weekly editor Dalton Ross hosted a poll that asked fans to rank every single season of Survivor for the first 35 seasons from best to worst. And he would rank up all the votes and show the rankings mathematically. And that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to watch every season from worst to best and review the seasons as we go along, starting from the worst and finishing off with the best of the best. And by the end, I will reveal my own rankings of the show. So I thought, as a Survivor fan and someone who genuinely enjoys looking at things of the past with a modern-day lens, I thought this would be a fun experiment. Starting with what fans voted as the worst season ever, the 22nd season, Survivor Redemption Island. So to catch up some non-fans, the premise of the season is that when you get voted off, you do not go home, instead you go to Redemption Island. Once you get there, you compete against other eliminated contestants, and if you survive the duel, you get to stay, and if you don't, you go home. And you do this for a certain number of duels until you can re-enter the game. This, I think, is, okay, not the biggest problem the fans have with the season, but it certainly does not help. The vote-off is the quintessential moment of the entire series. Your torch gets snuffed, and that's it. You leave the game. Having them get sent to a separate location means that all the tension of that moment has completely evaporated, and then after they do lose the challenge and burn their buff, it doesn't have that same effect, especially when you take into account how much of a non-factor Redemption Island becomes. It basically just feels like an afterthought, both the vote-off and Redemption Island itself. Every time someone re-entered the game, they got voted out immediately afterwards. It meant Redemption Island played no factor into the overall game. Matt got voted out second. He went to Redemption Island, survived 6 duels, and then as soon as he got back into the game, he was voted out again. But that's not even the biggest problem the season has. The biggest problem with the season is the sheer predictability of it, and the fact that Boston Rob's win is telegraphed to the audience from the word go. All of the people in his tribe basically worship him as if he's a god. He puts together an alliance of 6 people that will vote however he tells them. Eventually, Matt gets replaced with Philip, which we'll get to later, but basically that's the rest of the season. Rob steamrolls the competition, makes an alliance of 6, and somehow they all think he's taking them to the end. Seriously, Rob tells all of them that he's taking them to the end. I'll get back to the Boston Rob problem in a minute, but just he's so good at manipulating people without them even realizing it. Here we have a scene where he realizes that there's an idol clue hidden in the chair, and he gets Philip to get off his chair so he can look, and Philip doesn't even suspect a thing. The first few episodes, it was kind of entertaining just watching Rob run circles around these idiots. There's a scene where Boston Rob finds the clue to the idol that he already has, so he just throws the clue into the octavolcano behind him with the best shit-eating grin I've ever seen. And it gets even funnier when you think about, even if he didn't actually have the idol, he wouldn't even have needed the clue. He could just throw the clue in the volcano anyway, and had somebody else found the idol, they would have told him where it was anyway. He had basically the entire game wrapped around his finger. Boston Rob gave one of the most dominating performances in Survivor history. So it would seem like I'm praising this season, right? I mean, he's a great winner, it's a great performance, that should mean it's a great season, right? Just wait. When talking about this season, I had this whole section of the Zapateras written down. But as I was writing it, I realized it was more just acting like a recap, and there was nothing interesting to say about it whatsoever. Zapatera is really one of the most boring tribes in the entire show. All you have to know is that the reason the epic Rob versus Russell feud fizzles out and doesn't happen is because Russell gets voted out early on when his tribe throws a challenge with the explicit purpose of voting him out because he's a crazy person and the sooner he's gone, the better. Speaking of crazy people, Philip. What can I say about Philip? You know, I don't think I can properly articulate how much of a character Philip is. Now, do not get me wrong. Unlike the producers, I do not think eccentricity is always a positive trait in my Survivor characters. He's certifiably insane. You know, he'd probably call me racist for calling him crazy, because that is in fact something he actually did when someone called him crazy. Of course, Philip. Steve is calling you crazy because he's a racist. It couldn't possibly be because you are in fact really, really crazy. I mean, look at this shit. All right.
See you tonight.
Philip, does that inspire you when somebody kind of throws that in your face and says, this baby's coming back with us?
Oh, it brings out the animal in me. I will outlast any man over there.
What about the women?
That's another day. We'll see.
That's something you've faced in life before, being a little disruptive?
No, I wouldn't characterize it that at all. I'm actually a doer, and I'm one of
you be the man.
Here's to you, Julie. Don't mess with the undercover specialist, because he makes his living uncovering truth. And most people, like you, can't stand the truth. What did Jack Nicholson say to Tom Cruise? Son, you can't stand the truth. You can't take the truth. So that's what I'm saying to her.
You cannot mess with the specialist.
Time the Zapatera tribe was here, these fishnets remain in place the entire time. All of a sudden, both of them itchy.
I said you don't need as much as he does, and that's a fact. I didn't say that you didn't get to eat.
On our face
I told you.
You said
1,700 calories versus 3,600. That's it.
However, you getting rid of those things?
Yes.
I am so glad.
Look at how saggy those things are.
I knew that my manhood was not reflected in the briefs that I wear, but rather the character that I bring to the game. And so, with happiness and joy, as I approach my destiny.
Philip, I don't have any questions for you because, frankly, I'm sick of hearing your voice. So, I'm gonna speak. And you're not going to comment.
I will if I feel the need.
No, you're not.
Yes, I will. I'm doing it now.
That's really pathetic. You look really pathetic. I want to say my piece, so you're just going to sit there.
Don't, you know, say your piece, but don't tell me what I'm going to do.
First of all, you survived a torturous 38 days with you. I can get through anything, so thank you.
Well, you sound like a little whiny child.
Moving on.
He's obnoxious. He's overbearing. He's, I know this word is overused, but he's pretty cringeworthy. His antics don't start out annoying, it just plummeted into insanity. In the first episode, his craziness is actually responsible for the best first tribal council in an otherwise shitty season. Christina and Francesca are forced to include Philip in their alliance. Yes, really, because as I said earlier, everyone else is just a Rob zombie. So because these three are the only ones not under Rob's spell, they're forced into an alliance together. At some point, Philip just becomes another Rob zombie, and by tribal council, he spills everything about the alliance to Rob and his crew. It was an intense tribal council with everything from secrets being spilled to Philip wildly and amazingly butchering Francesca's name. Oh, I'm sorry, Francesca. It became bad really, really fast. Time to go back to that Boston Rob thing I promised we'd get back to. Rob has such a tight grip on the other contestants, that halfway through the season, it stops being fun and starts just being pointless. Like, why are we even continuing with this? It's obvious that Rob is going to win, and it only feels like the rest of the season is going on out of necessity. We can't just not do the rest of the season, but do not expect any strategy. None whatsoever. I know that in retrospect, a Survivor season always becomes the winner's story, but this isn't obvious just in retrospect. It's obvious when watching the season itself. Boston Rob eats up all the screen time, at least when Philip isn't doing something crazy. In fact, it's kind of sad that in one episode, the drama of the episode does not come out of who's going to get voted out, because we already know who's going to get voted out. It instead comes from, well, that race war I had mentioned earlier. That's another thing. Once Matt gets voted out second, there is absolutely no drama or suspense of who's going to go home. Hell, even on the opposite tribe, Zapatera, there's like just no suspense. The writing is on the wall. The writing is so on the wall, the producers don't even try bothering with the red herrings like they did with the season that just finished, Ghost Island. It's like, as soon as Rob wants to vote someone out, it's like, well, I guess that person's going home. The only reason people don't immediately hail Rob as the best winner in Survivor history is because look at the advantage he had. He was a veteran fourth-timer going up against a bunch of clueless, star-struck newbies. Let me reiterate, every single member of his tribe thought that he was taking them to the end. Every single one. And let me tell you, this season would have been a hell of a lot worse had we not gotten the deserving winner. And we were closer to that than a lot of people realize. So remember what I was telling you about Philip? Well, apparently, if you go and watch the Jury Speaks series of videos of this season, more than a couple of people were really hoping that Philip's villainy and insanity was all an act, a ploy to get Rob to take him to the end because he thought that Philip wouldn't get any votes. The players were so bitter against Rob for playing a better game than they did that they were almost willing to accept that strategy. So let me get this one thing straight. Even when Philip himself said that that was his strategy, I believe that just as much as I believe that all the fans on the fans tribe and Kara Moen were all in fact fans. But secondly, even if that strategy was real, is that really a game that you feel proud winning? Wouldn't you rather play a strategic game that's about being really good friends with someone, or having great social dynamics, or controlling people's votes? Being the person dragged to the end of the game is not a sign of pride, it's a sign of being a goat. Philip is a goat. His entire strategy consists of him being a goat. And here's the thing, like I said earlier, people were willing to buy it. They were so adamant about not wanting to be beaten by a returning player that had Philip sufficiently convinced them that this was all an act, they would have voted for Philip. We would have been talking about Philip as our Survivor winner. They were that bitter. There have been several people who said this in the Jury Speaks video. They did not like the way Rob played this game at all, even though it was pretty brilliant. Luckily, Philip is a socially inept jagoff and was in fact cursing out the jury members at the point where he's trying to convince them that he should win $1 million. So, luckily, that did not work out in his favor. Look, I can kind of understand about the Zapateras. But then, as a result of losing that challenge, they lost momentum and went into the merge with lower numbers. They were actually on the right track when they tried to get Matt on their side. It was a good strategy. Matt had already been voted out by his tribe. Why would he trust them again? They actually did everything. I mean, yeah, they threw that challenge. But you try spending 9 days starving and living with Russell fucking Hance and see how strategic your brain was. Russell was probably spending his time playing his mind games, just like his first 78 days in the game. We just didn't see it because the editors were kind enough to spare us Russell's madness. They had another returning player to shove down our throats. But then, as a result of losing that challenge, they lost momentum and went into the merge with lower numbers. They were actually on the right track when they tried to get Matt on their side. It was a good strategy. Matt had already been voted out by his tribe. Why would he trust them again? They actually did everything they could. Had Matt not been such a stupid head, this plan could have actually worked, and Matt would have saved himself from the extra however many days of Redemption Island he got. I mean, Matt, really, you're the one that screwed this up for the Zapateras, and there's a, like, another universe where I could talk about the insanity of Matt. You know what? Why don't we do that first before continuing on with this? Matt is not quite as crazy as Philip, but he's crazy in a different way. He thinks that some all-powerful deity, who, if he was real, probably has more important things to worry about than the placement of you specific individual on the 22nd season of a reality competition. But he insists that whether or not he wins or loses the duel, it's just God's will. As if God's the one who helps him win these competitions and not himself. And then, when he finally does get the chance to vote Boston Rob out, which he very well could have done, he decides to not do that, and instead he goes and tells Boston Rob about the plan. And then he throws Andrea under the bus too, and that's what results in him getting voted out a second time. Like I said, everyone had rice for brains in the strategic department this season. But anyway, yeah, the Zapateras did everything they could. It's just that Rob had such a tight control over his tribe. I would hope that they would respect legitimately good competition when they saw it, but human emotions are a real thing. And in the end, they did vote for the right person. It's okay to be a little bit bitter if, at the end, you grow past it and do the right thing. The Ometepes, however, have no such right to be upset at Rob for this. They had several opportunities to take Rob out. The Zapateras were literally begging them to make a move and vote Rob out. And they could have done it at any point. As I just said, Matt could have very easily said, "Why don't we vote Boston Rob out?" And the Zapateras would be like, "That's a great idea." But they all thought Rob was their number one, and they never bothered to talk with each other. So they never realized that Rob was telling all of them that he was taking them to the final tribal council. Understandably, though, they all give the finalists a run for their money. Only Grant and Matt address Rob as if he's done anything wrong, but all the other Ometepes get on Philip's case for being Philip, and Natalie's case for being the biggest coattail rider this game has ever seen. In the end, Ralph was the only one to vote Philip, and all the others voted Rob. And that's ultimately a good thing, because if Rob hadn't won the season, then this season really would have been completely worthless. I'm not saying this as a Boston Rob fan, but as a Survivor fan. No one else even gave an iota of a shit at beating Boston Rob, so Rob winning was really the only satisfying way the season could have possibly ended. It's the one thing that separates this season from the similarly awful season of Big Brother, BB19. That season arguably had less invisible players that weren't just the returning player, but they were also kind of more, like, annoying than the others. I mean, the one thing that BB19 has for over Redemption Island is that at least every one of them... BB19 is similar to Redemption Island, but the only real difference is that the jury of BB19 were really bitter. Paul is a lot like Boston Rob. He told everyone he was taking them to the end, and they all believed it, and they all got upset when he betrayed them. Other similarity between Big Brother 19 and Redemption Island is that it was really boring. And in both cases, none of them ever tried to make a move against the big returning player. The only reason that Redemption Island is at least a little bit better than Big Brother 19 as a story, because reality shows can be critiqued like stories, because in the case of Survivor, even though everything is really real, it's still taking 72 hours of time and condensing it into 43 minutes every week. So the editors kind of can shape the story however they want. So the story that they chose to tell was Boston Rob takes candy from baby. So the only satisfying end would have been Boston Rob winning. Big Brother 19 did not have that. I mean, to be fair, they don't edit it after the fact, they edit it during the fact. But anyway, the jury was super bitter and they all voted for Josh to win over Paul. And the interesting thing is that Josh is actually very similar to Philip. He was just obnoxious. Big Brother 19 is like if in Redemption Island, Philip had won, and we all had to sat here and pretend that Philip's antics and obnoxiousness and lunacy was in fact some great, brilliant strategy that totally meant he deserved to win over Boston Rob, when in fact, no, it's not. Philip and Josh are not brilliant strategists, they're just crazy. They're close, Philip. Before I close this out, some observations about the reunion show. First of all, the conversation between all the contestants was a lot less lopsided than I remember. The entire final nine, Julie and Russell, were all asked a question. That makes three whole Zapateras! I hate to continuously agree with Russell because I sincerely think he's one of the most annoying, overbearing contestants, but he's right. It was a bad decision for Zapatera to throw that challenge. Ashley admits that the girls knew Rob had the idol, so that's why they decided not to write down Rob's name at Final Five. Personally, if I were Ashley, I would make the move anyway, because I have individual immunity, so even if I vote for Rob, I'm not the one going home. Andrea is. A, that demonstrates that I'm out of Rob's control, and B, that means that the jury has a reason to respect me, and I finally added something to my resume. And let's not forget, Ashley was like 2 seconds away from winning final immunity. So with that, Rob is now completely vulnerable, and she could probably totally get Philip and Natalie and convince them to vote Rob out. And even if she doesn't get to convince them, she at least is still safe. So that is the really defining factor here. If I'm Ashley, I'd rather taste the risk and make the move. And even if it didn't work out, I'd at least want to do that so that I have at least a little bit of leeway in maybe beating Rob. I'm on record for actually saying that I think Natalie should have been brought back for second chance, because I imagine she would have played a much more aggressive game. Especially considering the fact that she had to watch her season play out, and she got to see, damn, I really am just riding Rob's coattails. And let's not forget, she is only 19 during the time of Redemption Island. Cambodia was 4 years later, so that's a good 4 more years for you to mature, which is a lot, I am told. In the end, like BB19, I think this season would have been much more interesting with no returning players. More so in BB19, but I do think it would be interesting to see how the players would have carried themselves without Rob. This season is a lot more fun to talk about than it is to watch. Once you've put the season behind you for a couple of years, it's easy to say, you know, I don't remember this season being truly awful as everyone says. Is it really that bad? And the answer is always a resounding yes. But that's the nature of a show like Survivor. With 36 installments and counting, it would make sense that there are some duds. And we're nowhere near done talking about all of them.